mindful of what you say. Be sincere when you pray. Today could be your last day. Bear each other no malice. Greed and faith can coexist in the same heart.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Salatu wa salamu ala ashrafil mursaleen. Nabina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Welcome to another episode of the Gems of the Heart, where we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify our hearts. And purification of the hearts is a duty, is something that is a must for the believers, for the human beings. Without purification of the hearts, people would never be able to enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised the believers in the hereafter that they would enter the Jannah, paradise, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created for the believers. And no one will enter Jannah unless they are perfectly pure. And this purification is to their hearts, to their actions, and to their speech. And the way to purify ourselves is to follow the revelation from Allah, to follow the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is the struggle that we go through in our life, to constantly purify our hearts. And as we talked about that meaning many, many times before, this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this life. Human beings, physically, they cannot sustain their life unless they are constantly purifying themselves. They don't even have to put, you know, or someone to put dirt on them. This is something that is so natural. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us, that if someone is in a very clean environment, he still has to clean himself. And without cleaning oneself, we become so much polluted and we have so much impurities and, you know, bad smells and so on. The same thing when it comes to our hearts. Our hearts, if we leave it, if we think that it's pure, it's good, then we praise ourselves, it might be fully contaminated and we do not feel it. And that's one of the major differences between physical aspects of things and the things done by the heart. So a person might have the heart full of filth, but nobody would smell anything physically. But this is when it comes to one's belief, one's actions, one's speech. We hear filth, we see filth. When it comes to the actions of disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is by itself is the worst impurity whatsoever. And the worst of all is when a person disbelief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, associate partners with Allah. So part of our duties on the face of earth is to follow the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in purifying ourselves. We've been talking about the names and attributes of Allah as one of the important means to purify our hearts, to purify our actions, by knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names and attributes, to understand what it means to believe in them and to act and to live our life according to the belief in these names and attributes of Allah. And as we heard before many times, there is nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all of the names and attributes of Allah, we believe in them the way they are reported in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, without distorting the meaning of it, without giving any resemblance to the human beings or similarities, without distorting the meaning of it, without denying any of it, but rather we submit ourselves and we believe in these names and attributes, we understand the meanings of it very well, and nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we do not know how these names or attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to denying any similarities to the human beings. One of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that are differences of opinions with regards whether it's a name or not, that's, you know, valid thing to happen. There are certain names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no doubt they are names of Allah. Names that are clearly mentioned in the Quran. As-Sami' al-Basir, the Al-Hearer, the Al-Seer. All of these names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are very clear. No doubt that they are names of Allah. But there are other names that sometimes the people of knowledge will have differences of opinions with regards to being whether it's a name or not. Because a name is something that has to be specifically mentioned as a name in the Quran or in the authentic Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. It is not permissible for anyone to invent a name to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the attributes is much more broader than that. The attributes can be so many attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without specifically mentioning that this is an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one of these names, that the attribute of it is correct, of course, and it's something that we should worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this attribute, but as far as the name is concerned, there's differences of opinions about it, is the name Al-Mughith. Al-Mughith, which means the one that rescues. the one that helps his slaves in a way that no one else have the power or the ability to help them except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it comes from al-ghawth, or seeking help or seeking rescue. You know, when someone is seeking a rescue from someone, that means he have no power whatsoever. When a person is in need of help, that means all the means, you know, it's been executed, there's nothing whatsoever that a person can do to save himself from trouble or from difficulties or whatever, when only the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be there to save him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that saves the believers. And that's why when we think about this, and this is an act of worship, by the way, is to seek help from Allah. And that's the outcome of believing in this name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when people seek help from other than Allah, so now we have to look at it from, first of all, the understanding of it, and to get to know the proper belief in it. People either will seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or from the other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seeking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, definitely it's an act of worship. We need to do that, and we'll talk about that inshallah ta'ala. But then before we talk about that, when we talk about seeking help from other than Allah, is it shirk? Is it associating partners with Allah? Is it haram? Is it permissible? It can be one of these categories. It depends on what a person do. For example, if someone seek help from a doctor, for example, because of an ailment that he's in, someone has a pain, for example, in his stomach, so he goes to the doctor and he tells him, I have a pain here, can you help me? There's nothing wrong with that. This is absolutely permissible, as long as the hearts are attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, as long as we put things in the right perspective, that human beings are human beings, they're deficient, they're limited. And by taking the means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permitted for us to take, our hearts are attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, that everything is by the permission of Allah, is by the power of Allah. Nobody can do anything except by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is permissible, to seek help from people in where people are able, in things that people are able to do. But what if it's something that people do not have the means and they have no capacity to do it, and people seek help from them? Meaning, if a person seek help from a dead person, someone in his grave, or seeking help from someone that is alive, but about something that he has no capacity to do. Like, for example, seeking help from someone to forgive the sins in the hereafter. Or to seek help from someone that is alive to make him enter Jannah. Or something that is, it's not in the capacity of the human beings. Or to prolong one's life. To go seek help from someone that is alive to say, I don't want to die in my 20s. I want to die when I'm in my 90s, for example. You know, this is something that has no reality to it. And that's why it becomes shirk and associating partners with Allah. When someone seek help from other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ways that they do not have the capacity and the means to do so. So it's only in where human beings, they have the capacity to do it. Those who are dead, those who passed away, they have no capacity and means to help anyone there is alive whatsoever. That's why calling the dead is something that is associating partners with Allah, which people should call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and this is mentioned throughout the entire Quran. So to get this taken care of, right, then we need to seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And even in the things that are permissible, even though it's permissible for a person to take the means, you know, the more the person is in no need of the human beings, the more the person is elevated. And again, it depends on the hearts and how the hearts are purified. To also to stress this meaning, we know the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ about the 70,000, those who would enter Jannah without reckoning whatsoever. They would not even have hisab or reckoning, they would enter Jannah straight. Their characteristics is about those who put their trust in Allah. And the hadith talks about these people. They are الَّذِينَ لَا يَسْتَرْقُونَ, one of which is they do not seek ruqya from others. Even though seeking ruqya, and ruqya is to recite something upon someone that is sick or so, and for the intention seeking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they will be cured. This is asking from someone, you know, if a person does it to himself, does it to others, this is absolutely fine. It does not make anyone weak in their relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if someone asks, this is the only thing, someone asks others to make ruqya upon them, you know, this is permissible, it's not haram. But it's not something that takes the person to the highest level of relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because the hearts might be attached to the one that is making that ruqya, and that's why they would ask from them. Instead, that they should do it themselves. And if someone do it to them without them asking, there's nothing wrong with that whatsoever. It is not weakness, it's not deficiency whatsoever. But this is a great example of how a person can elevate himself to always have the hearts attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regards to seeking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is, as we heard, is an act of worship. It actually would bring a level of happiness and contentment and comfort in our heart when we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this attribute. And again, as far as the name is concerned, there is differences of opinions. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, in the dua of al-istisqa, asking for rain, he would say this in his dua, Allahumma aghithna, wa Allah aghithna, the same from the root of al-mughith, meaning, O Allah, we seek help from you. And aghithna means it's not just seeking help, like the word has its effect as if you're seeking help from a human being. No, aghithna means when a person has no means to help himself whatsoever. It's the necessity, the level of necessity that comes into the word of rescue, for example. You know, usually the word rescue, they rescued someone that was in the middle of the ocean somewhere, right? Why? Because he has no means to protect himself. So when people seek this help or this level of necessity from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet ﷺ would turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone for rain, and he would say, Allahumma aghithna. And that's why Al-Ghayth is one of the names of the rain, because it only comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran in Surah Al-Anfal. Surah Al-Anfal, verse number 9, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the believers when they are in the battle of Badr. And how we know that in the battle of Badr, the believers, they were so much outnumbered by the disbelievers. The believers, the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, with the Prophet ﷺ, they was just a little bit over 300 individuals versus 1,000 of the disbelievers. So there's no compatibility here. And that's why they turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because according to the worldly means, the believers can never defeat the disbelievers, according to the worldly means. There's no way this can happen. But they turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, seeking help from Allah. So again, this is the level of seeking help. They do not rely on themselves. They know if they rely on themselves, they are defeated and they're ruined. That's one of the wisdom behind having this to be that status of the believers in such a way, so that the hearts are fully attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because even if people, they have so much wealth and power, imagine the believers versus the disbelievers in the battlefield. And imagine that the companions of the Allah anhum, they were so much in multiplication more than the numbers of the disbelievers. Imagine it was the other way around. The believers were 1,000 in number and the disbelievers were 300. And the believers had so much power and strength and so on. They should still turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed the matter for them to be like this, for a great reason, for them to reach this level of ibadah, for them to reach this level of necessity, as we see the verse, as we saw that verse just now on the screen, إِذْ تَسْتَغِيثُونَ رَبَّكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying about the companions of Allah anhum as a way to show the favors of Allah upon them. When you remember, when you تَسْتَغِيثُونَ, that's the verb of it. When you say you sought rescue, you sought help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your Lord, the one that created you, فَاسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responded to your seeking help from him, أَنِّي مُمِدُّكُمْ بِأَلْفٍ مِّنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ مُرْدِفِينَ, that I would aid you with 1,000 of the angels. And as you see, this is not worldly help. The help came from above, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though the victory is from Allah. That's why the next verse, it says, وَمَا جَعَلَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بُشْرًا وَلِتَطْمَئِنَّ بِهِ قُلُوبُكُمْ وَمَنْ نَصْرُ إِلَّا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not make this except to be a glad tidings for you and to comfort your hearts with it. And in reality, there is no victory except from Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that gives victory. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, the Most Wise, and so on. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave victory to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, when they turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this necessity in their hearts. We need to really reflect upon this meaning, because that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants, this level of feel in necessity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ignorance of the human being can make them reach a level where they eat and they drink. We even the fact that we're breathing now, Right, and this is by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But how many people, they have this in their hearts that it's not from them. We do not have that power and that ability. We need the help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we talked about being grateful to Allah and the favors of Allah. That whoever only remembers the favors of Allah when it's taken away from him, he is an ignorant person. We're supposed to be constantly in state of gratefulness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of the endless favors of Allah. And one of the very simple ones to remember, that is the fact that we're taking breath, you know, in and out and so on. To be believers, to be guided to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on. So the level of necessity that should be present in the hearts, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-mughith. He's the one that responds to the help that the believers are seeking. If you seek help from anyone, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that responds, because everything is under the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So having this as an act of worship, this will be in all of our affairs. Not just when a person is in dire need because he's in, you know, great trouble. Not for someone that is drowning or someone that is dying or someone that the doctors will say that according to the doctor's means and knowledge and so on, they have said their word. There's no means. There's no means of help for them to do. You know, it's only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it was before that also only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So people would turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a sincere dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cure and help and so on. This should be at all times. Even the salah that we pray. You know, Salatul Fajr, for example. If people to rely on themselves, they won't be able to do it. We need to rely on Allah. We need to have in our hearts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He wills for us to pray Salatul Fajr in the masjid, then nobody can stop us from doing so. So we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us, to make us among those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be on time, to be saved from sins, to be away from the path of sins and disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while taking the means. But one of the most important thing is to have that level of necessity in our hearts. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we look into the verses of the Quran, the essence of the tawheed and the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is about this. It's about the dua, it's about the level of necessity in dua, it's about seeking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's the major difference between the believers and the disbelievers in this matter. Right? And there is nothing worse for someone than to make istighatha, which from again the word al-mughith, to seek help and rescue from someone that is dead or someone that is absent, that would not benefit you by any mean or form, as people would say, oh, Sidi Fulan, oh, my master so-and-so, or the word Sidi or Sayyidi, or so, they call a dead person. They would, you know, go to a person in his grave, a righteous person, even if it's the Prophet ﷺ, even if it's righteous people, and they would call them and invoke them besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they would believe that they are the ones in their graves, they can help them or can they rescue them. You know, there's nothing worse in matters of shirk than this. That's what shirk is all about. That's what associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for someone to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be the Lord of the Alameen, they should turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with seeking help. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, for example, لَهِ يَسْجُدُ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make sujood everything in the heavens and the earth. مِنْ دَبْ, every single walking creature makes sujood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, humble itself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَالْمَلَائِكَ and the angels, وَمْ لَا يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ, and they're not having any arrogance in doing so. Everything is in that state of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So why then invoke other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The angels, the mighty angels that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, and they are much more stronger than the creation of the human beings, they are in constant worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have the fear of Allah, they hope for the rewards from Allah, because they know that everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we see how the angels that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, يَخَافُونَ رَبَّهُمْ مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ, they fear their Lord from above them, and they do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered them to do. So if this is the angels, then how should be then the believers, the human beings? They should turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in submission, and turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this level again of necessity. It's not something that needs a lot of convincing, because it's already very obvious for the believers, those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names and attributes. When we are ordered to follow the ways of the prophets of Allah, the Quran is full of verses that talks about the prophets of Allah and how they reached the perfect level of seeking help from Allah. They did not rely on themselves, on their power. They had this proper istighath and seeking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if the word is not mentioned with the same literal letters, istighatha, ghawth, and so on, but it's mentioned clearly in the Quran. Nuh alayhi salam, for example, وَلَقَدْ نَادَانَا نُوحٌ فَلَنِعْمَ الْمُجِيبُونَ. That means Nuh himself alayhi salam, he called, invoked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he sought help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Was Nuh alayhi salam seeking help from Allah and not taking the physical means? فَلَنِعْمَ الْمُجِيبُونَ. Who's the one that responded? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is best in responding to the call of his slaves other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did to Nuh alayhi salam? وَنَجَّيْنَاهُ وَأَهْلَهُ مِنَ الْكَرْبِ الْعَظِيمِ. We saved him and his family and his people from al-karb, the misery that is azim, very great misery and distress that they were in. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed everyone else. So how that, what came from Nuh alayhi salam, that he invoked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this with this level of necessity, you know, someone that would not be saved unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would save him. So how can we achieve this? You know, believing that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that saves, he's the one that saves his slaves, and having this belief is a necessity, of course, by default a believer should have this, and then to develop that in ourselves, to perfect it, we need to read the Quran. We need to reflect upon the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to see that clearly. If you look, for example, in Surah Al-A'raf, verse number 188, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, قُلْ لَا أَمْلِكُ لِنَفْسِي نَفْعًا وَلَا ضَرًّا إِلَّا مَا شَاءَ اللَّهِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's the best man ever. So if we need an example, we can never find better than the example of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and we are ordered to follow the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَا أَمْلِكُ لِنَفْسِي, I do not own for myself, نَفْعًا وَلَا ضَرًّا, benefit nor harm, إِلَّا مَا شَاءَ اللَّهِ, except what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will. وَلَوْ كُنْتُ أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبِ لَسْتَكْثَرْتُ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ وَمَا مَسَّنِيَ السُّءِ. And if I know the ghaib, if I know the unseen, I would have so much abundance of khair and goodness, and no evil or harm would afflict me. إِنْ أَلَا إِلَّا نَذِيرٌ وَبَشِيرٌ لَقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ. I'm nothing but a warner and a glad tidings, the one that gives glad tidings to the believers. So this is to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And when we look at the verses before it and the verses after it, and the verses of the Quran talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of all things, the sustainer, the provider. That's why the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are together for a person to believe in them, and it one lead to the other, and one is basically the implication of others and so on. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he addressed the people, when he called his people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's someone that they called him as-Sadiq al-Amin, the truthful one, the one that is trustworthy, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala perfected his manners and so on. When he addressed his people and he talked to the people of Quraysh, what did he say to them? He said to them, I'm great, follow me, I'm such a great example for all of you. Something that we need to reflect of what he said alayhi salatu wasalam, to show that level of necessity and being in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we'll talk about that inshallah ta'ala and more, to see that effect in the hearts of the believers, how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this name, or the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-Mughith, the one that is the one that respond to the rescue, the one that help the believers and rescue them from the evil within their own selves, from their enemies, from entering the hellfire, to be among the people of Jannah. It's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll be right back, so stay with us inshallah. Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. Welcome back, and we're talking about seeking help from Allah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Mughith, the one that rescues the believers and rescues the human beings. He's the one that to seek help from. And you said there's differences of opinion whether this al-Mughith is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not. There's no clear verse that talks about this being a name of Allah or authentic hadith. And that's why when it comes to the attribute, it's something that is definite, and we have to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regards to this meaning. And the verses of the Quran that talks about this are so many. It's basically the criteria for a person to know the differences between a tawheed, the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and associating partners of Allah with Allah. Those who invoke other than Allah, they seek help from them, whether they are in dire need or whatever. They are calling, invoking other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and other than Allah, they do not own anything. They don't have anything. And if they claim that these people that they invoke, or these human beings or whatever they worship besides Allah, they are righteous people, they are prophets of Allah, and so on, they themselves are someone that would seek help from Allah. They want to be close to Allah. So how can you invoke them besides Allah? This is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Isra. Surah Al-Isra, verse number 57. Surah Al-Isra, verse number 57. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about these things that they worship besides Allah. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ يَدُعُونَ يَبْتَغُونَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهُمُ الْوَسِيلَةِ أَيُّهُمْ أَقْرَبُ وَيَرْجُونَ رَحْمَتَهُ وَيَخَافُونَ عَذَابَهُ إِنَّ عَذَابَ رَبِّكَ كَانَ مَحْذُورًا. Which means, these things that they worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who they invoke besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they themselves, they seek the closeness to the Lord. And who would be among them the most closer to Allah? And they seek the mercy of Allah, and they fear the punishment of Allah. So basically, how can they worship them besides Allah, when they themselves are seeking the pleasure of Allah? They want to be close to Allah, they fear the punishment of Allah. So it shows that refuting this call for people, that when they turn to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and instead they should seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Really, there's so much practical implications to this. You know, something that we have to purify our hearts with. No one on the face of earth can benefit us, can help us. Nobody on the face of earth can bring goodness to us, except by the permission of Allah. People always confuse taking the means with the purification of the hearts when they turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Taking the means, it's permissible to take the permissible means and not the non-permissible means, because there are many non-permissible means. And one of the non-permissible means is when people get their hearts attached to other than Allah. When people would compromise their religion or disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect themselves or to push away harm and so on, who's the one that we seek help from? Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who's the one that would respond to this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why in all of our affairs, and that's why, for example, in Ayatul Kursi, the best verse in the Quran, in it Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ لِلْإِذْنِ. Who's the one that would be granted the intercession by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except by the permission of Allah? So even intercession, which is one of the tricks or the deceptions that the disbelievers they had when it comes to worshipping idols, and also many of the Muslims, those who would associate partners with Allah in their dua and are having their hearts attached to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of the subject of the shafa'ah. The subject of shafa'ah is a real one, and the Prophet ﷺ will intercede for the believers, and the believers will intercede for one another in the Day of Judgment. But that is only after the permission of Allah. As we know in Surah and in Ayatul Kursi, as we all know it and memorize it in our hearts, مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows what's in between their hands, what's before them, what's after them. Nobody can encompass any of the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, we seek even the intercession from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if someone wants to be granted the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then the person should die upon the tawheed, upon the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not going to be granted to those who worship other than Allah. And it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a way to honor the intercessor. And it would never happen unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with the one that receives the intercession. So this is something that we have to have that proper belief, so that even in that subject, a person would seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the things also that we get to know from this attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or this name al-Mughith, that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, when he first received the revelation from Allah, and he went to Khadija radiallahu anha, and he was, having this fear of what he saw, something that he'd never seen before after seeing Jibreel alayhi salam and so on. And he said, Zammiluni, Zammiluni, cover me, cover me. And Khadija radiallahu anha, she knew that this is not going to be a harmful thing for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not harm him. Why? Because she took an evidence of the actions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he helps the destitute and the needy and so on. But one of the things that she mentioned about the Prophet ﷺ, She said about him, وتغيث الملهوف, that you, O Prophet of Allah, تغيث, the same word, تغيث, you rescue الملهوف. الملهوف is the one that is in need of help and he has no means whatsoever. Someone that is, all the means are cut off from him. He has no means whatsoever to help himself, and the Prophet ﷺ would help them. And this is such a great quality from the human beings to do so. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that helps. So one of the effects of this belief in our hearts as, you know, the believers, that they need to help those who are in need of help, especially those who are in dire need of help. And the help for a person to offer to others, people are in different levels of this. You know, sometimes even people lie when it comes to that they are in need of help when they're not. And when it comes to the reality of those who are in need of help, they are in levels. So those who need the help the most, those who have no means whatsoever to protect themselves, to sustain their life, they are in a very difficult situation. Whoever helps them, they receive a great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so this is such a noble and a very rewardable act. As we heard in the hadith that Khadija radiallahu anha, she said that this is what the Prophet ﷺ used to do. And there are so many people now on the face of earth are in dire need of help. And for those people, those who would help them for the sake of Allah, a great reward is being promised for them as a way to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this name and attribute that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that protects and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that sends. And everything is by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, even when someone is in dire need and someone comes and helps them, of course they're grateful to them, but they also should have in their hearts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that sent them. That's why those who are being made easy for them to help the poor and the needy ones, they should not have arrogance or they would say they're better than others. They should witness clearly that the one that helped them to be honored to help the poor and the needy is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they should be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the ability to serve others. Not that people would brag about their actions or remind people of their favors. You know, that's why the companions radiallahu anhum, they used to be more in state of joy, much happier than when they give for the sake of Allah, more than the one that is taking. So if someone comes seeking help, begging for money or food or whatever, usually the one that is given, he's more happy with what he is given more than the one that gives. In many cases, those who give, they give and they have that struggle within their own selves and they don't like it. And the one that receives is much more happier than the one that gives. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the matter was opposite for them. Whenever they are given the opportunity to give something for the sake of Allah, they used to be more happier than the one that receives. Why? Because of this level of iman and faith and certainty in their hearts. That they understood that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants this action from them. So they're seeking rewards from Allah. It's a very difficult situation for the believers. When they have money, for example, and they don't know how to make sure that they spend it for the sake of Allah. Why? Because they know that they will be asked in the Day of Judgment about every single penny that they earn on the face of earth. How did they earn it and how did they spend it? So for when someone is being chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help the needy and the destitute, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that serves and the one that helps is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when someone is being put in such a way that he is a mean for people to help the people, they should be honored and they should be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped them. And he subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of all things. And that's why when we talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rescuing the believers and rescuing the people and helping them, for people, you know, this is a way, as we heard in the verse, for people to have their hearts purified, that they would see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one that helped them. And it's a great favor from Allah. On the opposite hand, if, say for example, the Muslims, they're seeking help from other than Allah, and the help came, isn't that a trial for them? It becomes a fitna for them. It's like someone going to the grave, to someone that is dead, and asking him for a favor. Like say, for example, you know, please let me have this job, for example. You know, it's a shirk to ask and invoke other than Allah. But say someone went to an idol or an image or someone in his grave or made dua to other than Allah, and they find that their dua got accepted. They got that job that they were seeking or the help that they were, you know, trying to receive and so on. Can you imagine the level of fitna and a trial that that person is in, he would take from this as an evidence that it worked. So therefore, he will continue to associate partners with Allah. And that's the worst thing that can happen to a person. That's why sometimes these things happen as a way to test the human beings. Because the believers, they don't test the ability of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't question the power of Allah. They don't make dua and to test how is it going to work. Is it going to be accepted or not? In a way that if it's accepted, mashallah, they will continue. If it's not accepted, they would not invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If a person has this in his heart, he might not be accepted his dua. He might even, if he associate partners with Allah, that he might be granted the answer then as a punishment from Allah. Why? Because the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, that He's the one that helps and rescues and so on, it doesn't need to be tested. It's something that is by necessity in the hearts of the believers. You know, something that you don't need to test it or to prove it to yourself. It's already given. It's by necessity in the human beings, inserted in them and installed in them, in their fitra, in their innate. So therefore, we should not fall into this trap. And that's why when a person makes dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they are in need of Allah, they should have the good thinking and the good expectations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept their dua. And the acceptance can be, they would be granted whatever they asked for if it's a matter of worldly gain, or equal harm is pushed away from them. That's acceptance. That's mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Or it will be saved for them in the hereafter with rewards or pushing away harm from them. And since the matter is coming, the people on the Day of Judgment, when they see their dua, their supplication that they invoked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with so much focus and truthfulness and so on, that part of the dua, that the acceptance of it was delayed for them, or the acceptance was there, but it's for the hereafter, they would wish that all of their dua that they made in this dunya, in this life, is delayed for them in the hereafter. Because there is no comparison between the reward and the goodness in this life and in the hereafter. Like, for example, if someone is sick and he keeps on making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for cure, to be cured, and this is a good thing and it should be done and a person should continue to do so. And it doesn't matter whether people would say or the doctors would say this is a terminally, you know, ailment, that means there's no means that they can do, and you know, most likely that he will die. All of these things, even if it's said to him, it doesn't matter. The believers, they know that everything is by the will of Allah. The human beings are limited. They don't have means, or their means are all taken care of and so on, but there's nothing else they can do. Or whether they took the means or they didn't take the means, everything by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that believer, when he makes dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure him, he should not say, well, since there's no means of cure, then let me make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something else. No, they should still ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure them. They ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything, to make them die in the state of Al-Islam, to make them firm upon the Iman, to make them among the people of Jannah and so on, and to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure. And does it mean that if a person died and he was not cured, that the dua is not accepted by Allah? This is wrong. A person's dua is accepted and he dies and he's not cured in this life, and the acceptance of the dua can be either more harm that pushed away from him. The acceptance of the dua, because he's invoking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can be that he died in the state of Al-Islam, that he received the reward in the hereafter because of that dua. This is acceptance of the dua. And that person, if his dua is accepted in the hereafter, at the moment of death and afterwards, he would not wish for himself anything better than what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained for him and decreed for him. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only ordain what is beautiful for the believers. This is the level of belief that should be in the hearts of the believers, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that we seek help from, and we do not seek help from anyone but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that level of necessity, as we heard. Nobody can do anything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أَمَّا يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَى وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءِ. Who is the one that would respond to the muttar? And muttar is the one that is in that level of necessity. There's no means to be taken. He took all the means and there's nothing whatsoever. like again a drowning person hanging to a log of wood in the middle of the ocean. He has no means of help whatsoever. Who's the one that would respond to that dua of that person in necessity? إذا دعا الله سبحانه وتعالى ويكشف السوء. Who's the one that lifts the harm and the evil? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who's the one who يجعلكم خلفاء الأرض? Who's the one that makes you successors on the earth? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the ayah says, أَإِلَهُمْ مَعَ اللَّهِ. Is there anyone to be worshipped and to be invoked with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? None of them is valid. You should not turn to no one but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَلِيلًا مَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. Little do you remember. That's why the human beings, they remember this. And that's why the believers, they should remember this a lot. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us to be or to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And nobody would benefit anyone but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, when he called his people, and this is what we just mentioned before the break, but I did mention it right after the break, is when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he invited the people of Quraysh to the deen of Islam and presented the truth to them and the tawheed, to worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said to them, ishtaru anfusakum, that means purchase yourself, save yourself from the punishment of Allah. La ughni ankum min Allah shay'a. I would never avail you anything from Allah. That's the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he kept calling people, one tribe after the other. And even he called, he said, Safiya radiallahu anha, the aunt of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told her, to save herself from the punishment of Allah, لا أغني عنك شيئا من الله شيئا. I would never avail you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala anything, even though that the Prophet ﷺ, she is his aunt. The same thing for the daughter of the Prophet ﷺ. Can she rely on the fact that she's the daughter of the Prophet ﷺ? That the Prophet ﷺ is the most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that if he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for anything, he would grant him, and one of which is the salvation of his daughter, for example. Prophet ﷺ said, you save yourself and I would never be, or I can never avail you or benefit you to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if a person is a disbeliever. And that's why the uncle of the Prophet ﷺ, he died in the state of disbelief. So the fact here is it's to purify the hearts again, that the hearts are to be attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one that helps. And that's why Al-Mughith, the one that give this Ighatha or this rescue. If you know some Arabic, you know they even give the title of the agencies, the relief agencies, they call it Hayatul Ighatha, the agencies of Ighatha, the agencies of relief. They relieve people, they help people and so on. And who's the one in reality that helps people when the people are not able to do anything? It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the people and the human beings and the means within the possessions of the human beings, it's all owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to perfect one's tawheed, to perfect one's iman, is to get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his names and attributes, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this belief, so the hearts are fully attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And if you need help, don't worry about the human beings, forget about the human beings, turn to the creator of the heavens and the earth alone. Worship him, be obedient to him, turn to him in his dua. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala listens to the dua of the believers. And that's why we will have the concern how to perfect our dua, how to make our dua accepted, how to prevent ourselves from eating haram, from earning haram, because these things prevents the person's dua to be accepted by Allah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the dua of the believers. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us benefit from what we heard, and to make us among those who have the knowledge of the names of and attributes of Allah, and to make us truthful in worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with these names and attributes. Until next time, with another name and attribute of Allah. So till next time, I leave you with the protection of Allah. Wa sallallahu sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wa assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Mindful of what you say, be sincere when you pray. Today could be your last day. Bear each other no malice. Greed and faith can coexist in the same home.